Mr. Speaker, October of next year will mark 20 years since the war in Afghanistan started. That's a generation of devastation in Afghanistan, a generation of our men and women in uniform being sent to fight and die for a war with no exit strategy. And still to this day, there are people saying that we shouldn't be too hasty in leaving. Too hasty? It's been two decades. There will never be a perfect time to withdraw our troops. There will never be a time when making the right decision does not include some risk. Our obligation to Afghanistan's stability will not end when our troops leave. My amendment sets a clear timeline and clear congressional intent that we must end our country's longest war. We put this debate in context. I want to say this amendment was offered by my friend, Chairman McGovern, 7 years ago. It passed the House in 2013 with the majority of both parties voting in favor. During that debate, Mr. McGovern stood on the floor and said, I quote, "The future and fate of tens of thousands of uniformed men and women deserve a vote." The House took that vote, and 305 members of this body voted to end the war in Afghanistan. Yet since then, we have had 7 years of fighting and sustained violence, 7 years of civilian casualties, 7 years of service members being forced to say goodbye to their families and subjected to a terrible trauma. In many years, it's baffling to me that I have to do this. But I echo Mr. McGovern's words from 2013. The future and fate of thousands of uniformed men and women deserve a vote. As a survivor of war, I can tell you that even one more minute of conflict comes with a cost that's too great for most to imagine. Finally, I want to say that I do not believe that the end of military engagement should be the end of our obligation to the Afghanistan people. My amendment calls for a comprehensive peace plan that includes all sectors of civil society. It calls for renewed engagement on diplomacy and development. It calls us to fulfill our moral and strategic obligation, but not to risk one more life of American service members in a war with no clear objection.
Assalamu alaikum and hello everyone. I'm your host, Hannah Zuberi, and welcome back to another episode of Justice for All Now. You're watching us on Muslim Network TV, America's only Muslim-focused network. You can watch us 24/7 on Samsung Galaxy 19, Amazon Fire TV, Roku TV, and Apple TV. The House of Representatives on Tuesday voted down a proposal by Representative Ilhan Omar to accelerate the withdrawal of American troops from Afghanistan and help bring a close to the longest war in U.S. history. The Minnesota Democrats' amendment to the National Defense Authorization Act fell by a vote of 129 to 284. With 103 House Democrats joining 181 Republicans in voting no. If passed, Omar's amendment would have removed from the House NDAA language inserted by Representatives Liz Cheney and Jason Crow that imposed a series of vague conditions on U.S. troop withdrawal from Afghanistan. Joining us today is Sangar Piker. Sangar Piker is the founder of Afghan Eye podcast and has a background in journalism, governance, and social sciences. He's joined us before on this show. He graduated from the School of Governance and Global Affairs in The Hague and has studied journalism at the postgraduate level at Leiden University, where he's a guest lecturer. So I welcome Sangar on the show. So we can talk about what happened, what transpired, and what this means for the Afghan people. Welcome back, Brother Piker.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you for having me.
thank you for having us, for being here on the show. It's, you know, when we watch these developments happen on the floor of our Congress, we really wonder how this transpired, what this actually means for the people on the ground, for Afghans in the diaspora. So, for those of us, for those of the viewers who may not have watched our last episode where we featured your work, please tell us a little bit more about yourself and the work that you do.
So in short, I was born in Afghanistan. I spent the first years of my life as a kid in Afghanistan, but then after a while, around the time when I became a teenager, we fled Afghanistan, and my parents, they brought us to the Netherlands, and we applied for asylum here, and I've been living here in the Netherlands ever since. I did travel back to Afghanistan shortly after the fall of Taliban regime and establishment of the new government. I tried to see if I can establish myself back in Afghanistan and start a life as a normal Afghan there. But unfortunately, it was very difficult. So I moved back to the Netherlands, and I've been working as a translator, a communication expert for the last 10 years. And we have recently launched the Afghan Eye podcast, so about 3 months ago. Mm-hmm. And we are trying to provide a counter narrative to what is being said about Afghanistan, about the current situation in the mainstream media, because we feel like there are certain aspects of this conflict that are not being covered as they should. Mm-hmm. And we are trying to add input into the political discourse about Afghanistan. And alhamdulillah, it's been going well. We had very interesting guests. So that's what we are doing at the moment.
Well, thank you so much for your work. And it's, you know, we do need to hear Afghan narrative by Afghans themselves. A lot of times we have people speaking about this issue who claim to be experts. But you know how that goes. Now, you know, when I saw this news that had come down, we follow the National Defense Authorization Act closely because being anti-war, being a pro-human rights organization, it's very important to see what gets. Now, this is the big omnibus bill. Like, this is where everything gets tacked on. You'll find things being tacked on there that have nothing to do with defense. But, that bill has to be passed. It has to be voted on. So it's not something that will get stuck on the Senate floor or on the House floor. So in this escalation that led up to Ilhan Omar's proposal to withdraw troops in a quicker manner from Afghanistan, there is a lot of history of United States-Afghanistan relations that some may have forgotten. So please, let's do a little bit of past history to contextualize this. So please describe some of that history between these relations to bring some of our viewers up to speed.
So in the 20th century, Afghanistan used to be a monarchy. And as a monarchy, we had a king, and Afghanistan was during the Cold War not really aligned to either the Warsaw Pact or the NATO, you know, the Western countries. However, due to a revolution by a progressive leader in Afghanistan, Daoud Khan, Afghanistan sort of became aligned with the Soviet Union. And this shortly escalated into a civil war, and the Soviet Union, they were supporting a particular faction in Afghanistan who are Marxists, and that Marxist faction, they overthrew Daoud Khan, who was a progressive president. And when they overthrew him, they established a socialist, Marxist, or communist, or however you would like to label it, a new government supported by Soviet Union. And prior to this, the United States was very supportive of the Afghan government. The king of Afghanistan, Zahir Shah, he even visited the United States in the 60s, I believe. The United States funded many developmental projects in Afghanistan. But once Afghanistan became aligned with the Soviet Union and once things escalated and we ended up in a civil war, the Soviet troops entered Afghanistan and the United States supported the rebels, the Mujahideen, against Soviet occupation. So that's when the relationship between United States of Afghanistan became more problematic, because the United States, they supported the Mujahideen in Afghanistan against the Soviet Union. But once the Soviet Union, when they decided to pull out of Afghanistan, the United States basically disengaged from Afghanistan. Afghanistan, its internal politics, its civil war, didn't really matter to United States all the way until the 90s, late in the 90s, where Osama bin Laden traveled from Sudan to Afghanistan, where he used to stay. Like Osama bin Laden, he was in Afghanistan during the 80s. He participated in the fight against the Soviet Union. So when he returned back to Afghanistan, that was in a particular time when he was posing threats against the United States. He was threatening the allies of United States. So that's what that was during the Clinton administration. And after many threats, verbal threats by Osama bin Laden and terrorist attacks in Kenya, the United States bombed several places in Afghanistan. It was in the late 90s. It was during the time when President Bill Clinton was also engulfed in a scandal. So it didn't really register with the American people what is happening in Afghanistan, all the way until 2001. The 9/11 terrorist attacks happened, and immediately it was said, well, the Al-Qaeda is responsible for the attacks, and the current government in Afghanistan, the Taliban, they are hosting, or they're providing sanctuary for this group. Therefore, we must invade Afghanistan, retaliate, overthrow their government. And that's what happened in 2001. So the United States invaded Afghanistan, they overthrew the Taliban, they created a new transitional government, and the transitional government consisted of many former allies of the United States, people who participated in a war against Soviet Union. And there were people who are from United States, like our current president. He used to live in the United States, and the previous president as well. These are people who had very close ties with the United States. So they formed a new government in Afghanistan, and that new government is still in power. It's entirely supported by United States and its allies. Afghanistan's armed forces are also supported by United States. And they are at war with the Taliban, because the Taliban, they say, we used to be a legitimate government and you guys have overthrown our government and you're invading our country. So this is what the war ever since is sort of, yeah, more or less that's what it's about.
Now, and withdrawal has been promised. That was one of President Donald Trump's campaign promises as well. So what are some of the most important aspects of the plan to withdraw troops from Afghanistan before Representative Ilhan Omar proposed to amend the plan and withdraw troops faster? So what were some of the original plan that was, you know, why was that controversial?
Well, the thing is that over the last 19 years, the United States and United States allies, they have invested billions of dollars in creating military outposts all over Afghanistan. There are huge military bases in Afghanistan. Some of them are as big as entire cities. Mm-hmm. And United States forces, they have been there for now 19 years. So once the Trump administration agreed to withdraw troops from Afghanistan and initiate a peace process with the Taliban and the Afghan government, in that agreement that was signed in the beginning of this year between the United States and the Taliban representatives, in that agreement, they have said that in the first 135 days, they will pull out about 5,000 U.S. troops. And in the next 14 months, in a period of 14 months, they will entirely pull out all their troops out of Afghanistan. Mm. So that was the initial plan. But then Donald Trump, he said that if it's possible, if we can, we will speed up the process of withdrawal. And we might even pull out all our troops before the 14 months have passed. Mm-hmm. So that was said before the proposal by amendment proposal by Congresswoman Ilhan Omar. Yes.
So Liz Cheney, who is the daughter of Dick Cheney.
Yeah.
Who are, you know, so we'll discuss Dick Cheney. Okay, we'll get back
some other time.
Yeah, some other time. I think we should do a whole show about Dick Cheney. But that's his daughter. So she and Jason Crow, who she's a Republican. So, you know, United States has this two-party system. And Jason Crow, who's a Democrat from Colorado, they put in these conditions in the this language of the House Amendment and, you know, National Defense Authority Authorization Act. These provisions require that before the number of U.S. troops stationed in Afghanistan can be reduced below 8,000, the Pentagon must certify that withdrawal will not increase the risk for expansion of existing or formation of new terrorist safe havens inside Afghanistan, and is, quote unquote, in the best interest of U.S. national security. So what does this mean? Let's look at this. This language, and this is what I feel like that is what we need to explore, because that is the language that Ilhan Omar wanted to strip down. So will not increase the risk for expansion of existing or formation of new terrorist safe havens inside Afghanistan. So I'd love to get your comment on that.
Okay, so the United States and the Taliban negotiated for almost 2 years about this particular matter. The point of this contention was the United States, their cause for invading Afghanistan was that Afghanistan was a safe haven for terrorist organizations, Al-Qaeda in particular. So they said that the Taliban are hosting Al-Qaeda, and as long as you're not going to host them or any other terrorist group that poses a threat to United States and its allies, then we will agree to pull out. So the Taliban, they have promised the United States that they will not allow Afghanistan, its territory, to be used by any terrorist organization or anyone in particular to pose a threat to the United States and its allies. So that's the main point of agreement between the two parties. Now, Afghanistan has many problems as a country. And one of the biggest problems is that we don't have a centralized government, a centrally functioning government that can provide security for the people in Afghanistan. So there are large parts of the country where there is basically no government. So any agreement wherein it states that either one or the other party will ensure that this or that happens, and we have to weigh in the situation in Afghanistan, how the geography and its history, we'll have to acknowledge that it's very difficult to make such promises. But still, the United States and the Taliban have agreed on this particular matter, because The reason why the United States was at war with the Taliban is because they were providing a safe haven for Al-Qaeda. And they have said, we won't do that anymore. Al-Qaeda has no place in Afghanistan. And for the last 10 years, if you check all the official sources, official statements by the United States, the Afghan government, they haven't really arrested or killed any significant Al-Qaeda leaders in Afghanistan. They haven't discovered a major Al-Qaeda camp in Afghanistan. So that's out of the equation, okay? We can safely say that in Afghanistan, Al-Qaeda basically doesn't really exist anymore. A different problem that does exist in Afghanistan is Daesh, or the Islamic State, as it calls itself, Islamic State, Khorasan province. This particular terrorist organization has emerged in the last 4 or 5 years. And this particular terrorist
group, we call it the non-Islamic State.
Yes, it's not, and it's a non-Islamic state. So this group, they are basically posing a threat to everybody. And that's why in most eastern parts of Afghanistan where Daesh operates, they have been subjected to a massive campaign by the Taliban. They have been defeated in most part of eastern Afghanistan. There are some reports, very dubious reports, that suggest that Daesh has 10,000 or even more fighters in the north, but there is no evidence. It's just being said, but there is no evidence. What does matter is that in those particular regions, in Nangarhar, in Kunar, in those regions where Daesh was established, where they were actually observed by locals, by even journalists, by other observers, in those areas, they're totally annihilated. Mm-hmm. And Secretary Pompeo, he even acknowledged that the Taliban have been very successful in eliminating Daesh in Afghanistan. So when Jason Crow or Cheney, if two of them, if they say that there needs to be a specific guarantee from either one or the other part that Afghanistan will not provide any sanctuary for terrorist organizations, it seems to me that they are just making an excuse to prolong the war. Yeah. Because everything that needs to be done is already done, and it is being done right now. So I don't understand what else do they want? How do they want to put conditions in what form, in what order? So it's very confusing, and that's why I do understand that Ilhan Omar and also other people in the United States, they have commented and they said that this is vague, it's not productive, and it's not really solving anything. Mm. So that's why her amendments made a lot of sense to me, because they're not practical.
So you think that Ilhan Omar's plan would have been a positive addition to the plan to withdraw the troops. What additions would you have made if you had had the chance?
I would say that the defense budget in the United States is a very significant part of the entire government budget. Mm-hmm. And it has been wasted in Afghanistan for 19 years. Mm-hmm. US taxpayers, they have a right to demand from their government some sort of explanation of what happened to their money. And they should ensure that any future defense budgets have a stronger mechanism to prevent waste, and also to prevent the United States defense forces to just engage in wars in countries where there is like let me point out to another very important issue here. You see, occupying a country for this long, there is no legal justification for that. So the United States defense forces were being used in a very long war that didn't have any legal basis. And so that's why it's very important that the defense budget also has a very strong mechanism that prevents the government from engaging in any wars or wasting U.S. taxpayer dollars in projects that are not actually legal. Because from a very strict legal perspective, there is no justification for occupying Afghanistan.
Exactly. And this is why Stephen Miles, the executive director of Win Without War, great friend of ours, when he commented on this, he said that the House passed a nearly identical provision several years ago with unanimous Democratic support. So this is very interesting to me to watch this. Is number one, have Democrats become more hawkish or and as Miles says, you know, is that a lot of House Democrats wrongly viewed this as a vote against Donald Trump rather than a vote to end our nation's longest war. So, we've become so partisan when it comes to this, that this is something Donald Trump would support. So now the Democrats would vote against it just because it might make Donald Trump look good for actually ending this war. So this is something that really is interesting for me to look at closely. And, they can oppose Donald Trump and end endless wars at the same time. What are your thoughts watching from outside the country?
There is a observation of American politics. Obviously, America is like Rome. So it's the most powerful and most dominant state and government in the whole Western Hemisphere. But even outside the Western Hemisphere, everybody's watching and listening and observing what's going on in Afghanistan, in the United States. And what I have gathered in the last few years is that the politics in the United States has become much more partisan and polarized, and it's no longer about real life solutions but more about who you support, and I think this is detrimental for domestic politics as well as foreign politics, because as you have described, I agree, I think that the Democrats are siding with this particular point specifically because they want to oppose Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. And Donald Trump is a very divisive figure, and his views and opinions are considered as un-American by a very significant part of American people. And while he is very divisive and while he's very polarizing as a president, we have to bear in mind that the war in Afghanistan is a huge waste. It's a huge burden on U.S. taxpayers. Mm-hmm. It has created thousands of maimed and disabled young men and women. All these people who return back from Afghanistan, they have PTSD. Somebody have to pay for all of this, and somebody have to be held responsible for if this war lasts any longer, because there is nothing really to be gained here in Afghanistan. The United States is only making more enemies at the expense of the American taxpayer. So that's why for the Democrats, it's very important that they move beyond their party politics and their problems with Donald Trump and the Republican Party. And they should put the interests of the American people first. And they should decide that if this war last any longer, it will harm the American people. It's basically as we have hosted a army veteran. Mm-hmm. His name is Eric Edstrom. He has recently published a book called Un-American. I advise everyone to read his book because it's very enlightening. It describes how American occupation of Afghanistan was a huge failure on many grounds. And he said that we are basically bankrupting our country by prolonging this war in Afghanistan. And even the arguments that are being used to extend the war, none of them have any practical meaning. So that's why it's very important for both parties, the Democrats and the Republicans, to come together and decide that they should really speed up the process. So that's why I think that
I'm going to cut you. I'm going to share with you the House. Our Congress is split into Senate and then the House, right?
Yes.
So the House Foreign Affairs Committee ranking member, Representative Michael McCaul. He's a Republican from Texas. So even the Republicans underneath Donald Trump. So this man, he's the ranking member. So that he's the highest ranking Republican in the Foreign Affairs Committee. So he says this text talking about Ilhan Omar, and I want to examine this and also think a lot about the Islamophobia, anti-Muslim bigotry as we look through all of, because none of these frameworks can, you know, we cannot look at any policy without looking at through these lenses as well. Because a lot of times we don't discuss what does it mean that Ilhan Omar was the one who presented this amendment? Would it have been different if some, a white man had presented this amendment? But that's something that I'd love to get your comment on. But aside from this, he says this text one-sidedly declares it to be the policy of the United States to complete the withdrawal of U.S. troops from Afghanistan by April. It directs what the president shall do, but makes no mention of the Taliban's obligation that would render any withdrawal more advisable or feasible. And then he goes on to say that the president, Trump, has been withdrawing down the troops, and he also has and needs the authority to maintain a residual force to address potential counterterrorism needs and the shifting situation on the ground. And again, and I know you talked about this already, the Al-Qaeda's presence, and then he goes on about Taliban must uphold to his commitments, including cutting ties with Al-Qaeda or face the consequences. So, so even the Republicans in this have been that makes it really, I'm trying to, be like, where is this going? You all were the ones who made this policy. And this is, and the Afghans have been adhering to this policy. So this is something that has been quite interesting for me to keep, note. But yes, that how is this going to affect Afghani people on the ground? The politicians in charge tend to forget the conditions that the Afghans face. So let's talk about that.
So first of all, what the Republican politician has said, I just forgot his name.
McCaul.
So what he has said, it implies that the United States has decided to hand over authority in Afghanistan to the Taliban, which is not the case. The Taliban are an opposing party to foreign troops in Afghanistan. However, we still have a government with all its imperfection. It is a government and it has some power in Afghanistan. So what needs to happen is that the Taliban and the government and people who are not part of either government or the Taliban, so basically the civil society, political organizations, social movements, they all need to come together and create a stable, peaceful Afghanistan. And this needs to happen under supervision of international community. And the United States plays a major role. This is also one of the things that Ilhan Omar was hinting at in the video beginning of this show, that the United States are not just pulling out of Afghanistan and just there leaving everything to be. That's not the case. And that's not what is being suggested. But what is implied by McCaul is that the Taliban have gained all the authority over Afghanistan, and that's not the case. So they cannot provide all the assurances that Afghanistan will not be used by Al-Qaeda or whatever. This is something that needs to be sorted out by all parties involved in Afghanistan, so all internal parties. So that's a very important point. There is another issue with the American politics is that on both sides of the aisle, the Republicans and the Democrats, they are being influenced by lobbyists. These lobbyists and interest groups, they have their own agenda. And many of these lobbyists and interest groups who are basically whispering in the ears of either this or that politician, they're basically saying, no, you should vote in favor of this amendment or that amendment. You should support this bill or that bill for this and that reason. And what is very important for people to realize is that those interest groups have a major influence in how policy is being shaped. And the interests of certain interest groups like the military industrial complex, the very powerful organizations, they have a say on both sides of the aisle. And this is something that people should be aware of. And this is also one of the reasons why I think on both the Republican and the Democrat side, there are people who are trying to make the process of withdrawal more complicated. Because the longer the foreign troops remain in Afghanistan, the longer the United States, their troops remain in Afghanistan, the more work, the more job opportunities they provide, the more contracts they provide for all these private military contractors, producers of weapons. And on our side in Afghanistan, we also have very powerful Afghan politicians who are trying to use the American lobbying system to influence American politicians. They in Afghanistan, they are using social media and the media to campaign for basically making the process of withdrawal more extended or even stopping the withdrawal because they think that they will lose if American troops withdraw. They think about their own interests, and their interest is, as cynical as it may sound, invasion of Afghanistan has resulted in an economy in Afghanistan that is entirely dependent on war and occupation. And those people who have built their empires in Afghanistan on war and occupation, their contractors, they provide fuel to foreign troops, they provide transportation, they provide all sorts of services for foreign troops. Those people, they are now very powerful, and they also don't want foreign troops to leave.
Sure. So one of the, actually I had a question for you, is that, how do you think Representative Ilhan Omar's amendment could impact the U.S. and Taliban talks, which have come out in full fruition, have not come into full fruition, like as there has been much violence that's been taking place since the ceasefire failed in earlier in February?
If I may, I need to go back to something you said earlier before about Ilhan Omar. It's very important to note that Ilhan Omar is a black woman who's wearing a hijab and who pronounces her faith as a Muslima. And this does have a huge impact on what she says and what she does. Mm-hmm. So when she suggests something as a politician, obviously there are people who will perceive it in a certain light because of her faith, because of her skin color, because of her gender. All these things matter. So what's important to note is that even in Afghanistan, we have people who obviously are in favor of continuation of the current system and occupation of Afghanistan. And they were spreading all sorts of lies about Ilhan Omar. They were saying that she insulted the people of Afghanistan, that she said very derogatory things about the people of Afghanistan. So she was being insulted. There was racially charged abuse, misogynistic language being used against her on social media by people who are saying, oh, she insulted our country by suggesting that the foreign troops need to pull out. So you see that in politics.
And can you explain to me why that would be an insult to have foreign troops pull out?
See, here's the problem. When Ilhan Omar or any other politician, when they speak in the House, most people never listen to that. They just read headlines and they just read what is being said on social media. So there are very toxic figures on social media, very significant figures in Afghanistan with hundreds of thousands of followers, and they just simply make up a lie. They said that she insulted the people of Afghanistan, which is absolutely not true. That's not what she said. But most people, they just go by what they, what someone they follow on social media said. So they were insulting her, and it's very important that when as a particular suggestion, a proposal is made, the person who is making the proposal is subject to all sorts of biases. So it's the case in the United States, but also elsewhere around the world. So this is one point that I wanted to make.
No, it's you a very asked powerful point. It's a very powerful point, because a lot of times, especially those of us who might be watching this from here, we're not monitoring or looking at Afghan media or Afghan social media figures, who's driving, you know, policy, or who's driving like public opinion. And to have that, no, thank you so much for making that point, because that's extremely, it adds to the layers of, you know, already the misogyny, the, you know, internalized Islamophobia, all of that. And plus fake news, or just spreading, as you said, yes, and watching what she's saying, but spreading it. So we're like, people like her are facing, like just hits from all sides. It's like, yes, you know, why yes wouldn't, you know, so this yes is, this is very, this is, thank you for adding that element.
So with regards to your question, her suggestion, her proposal was basically to speed up the process of withdrawal. And in Afghanistan, what happened after the signing of the agreement between United States and the Taliban is that the Afghan government, our current president, he was aware of what is being discussed between the United States and Taliban from the beginning. He knew about all the details that are being discussed. So when the United States and Taliban agreed that 5,000 Taliban prisoners need to be released, and 1,000 Afghan police and army prisoners who are captured by the Taliban, that they're also, they need to be released within 10 days after signing the agreement. The Afghan government was initially on board. They said, we support this decision. The United Nations, they endorsed this agreement. So all of this could have gone much faster if the Afghan government would cooperate with releasing those 5,000 Taliban prisoners, and the Taliban released those 1,000 Afghan soldiers and police officers. But this didn't happen, because the Afghan president is saying all sorts of contradictory things ever since. The prisoners weren't released in the first 10 days. We are now months ahead, and things are turning really volatile in Afghanistan. There are more attacks, there are more fighting all over the country. Generally, the security situation in Afghanistan is worsening, because people on the Taliban side, they say, well, we have an agreement and you guys are not abiding by an agreement, so therefore we can continue attacking Afghan troops, Afghan soldiers, Afghan police officers, because they were not part of the agreement. So they're not attacking American troops, they're not attacking foreign troops, they attack Afghans. So it means this process is costing many lives in Afghanistan. Most of the people who are dying right now are Afghan soldiers, police mm-hmm. officers, and Taliban fighters, who are all Afghans. So if Ilhan Omar's proposal to speed up the process of withdrawal would have been accepted, this would have had a significant role in current situation, because then the Afghan government would be forced to abide by the agreement signed by the United States and the Taliban and release the prisoners, because once the foreign troops leave Afghanistan, once the Americans leave Afghanistan, the current government is not capable of continuing a protracted war against the Taliban. This is not possible. This government will suffer, and there will be a lot of chaos and a lot of bloodshed in Afghanistan if these two sides are not forced to sit and talk to each other and reach an agreement. And that agreement needs to be enforced, because the United States, their troops, they are somehow they're like a they're providing a sense to the Afghan government and its leaders that as long as these troops are here, we're in power, we don't have to do much. We can just stay and do whatever we want. And that's basically the mentality in Kabul. And most people in Afghanistan are very angered and frustrated by this particular stance of our current government. Our president is not being cooperative. And they are not doing enough to speed up the process. So if they are not doing enough to speed up the process, then the pressure must come from the United States, because they are the power backing this government. So what Ilhan Omar suggested, it would be like a means to pressure Afghan government to be more cooperative.
So as we're getting ready to wrap up the hour, I just want to talk about the ICC case. This is something that, as I've said this before too, I believe our government should be held responsible for war crimes in Afghanistan. And the ICC has collected at least 1.17 million statements from Afghans who claim to be victims of war crimes during this investigation of crimes committed by the Taliban, by Afghan government forces, and the U.S. military. So as this moves forward, and, you know, like we were talking about Ilhan Omar and all of that, but, I, you know, this is something that I want people to focus on, because this has obviously caused a big uproar in the United States as well against the ICC. But how important is this?
It's very important, because when there is a conflict in Afghanistan, the war has been going on for more than 40 years now, okay? When there is a conflict, when there is blood being shed, when there are people being killed, when there is injustice, in order to bring back stability, in order to bring back some sort of sense of normality in a society, people who have shed blood and people who have oppressed others, they need to be either punished, or there needs to be some sort of reconciliation. Mm-hmm. Okay? As human beings, this is how we operate. Even when we were children, when brothers and sisters or brothers and brothers, when they were fighting, the parents would say, okay, you go to your room, or you face some sort of punishment, or make amends. And in order to bring back stability in Afghanistan, there needs to be some sort of justice. Mm-hmm. And it's necessary. Why? Because when the United States invaded Afghanistan in 2001, they said, well, the Taliban are the bad guys, and mm-hmm. everyone else are the good guys. Yeah. So let's support everyone else against the Taliban. And they supported people who have committed most horrific crimes in the last 40 years in Afghanistan. People who have committed genocide. They have like most horrific things that I can't even mention. They've done this in Afghanistan. And these people were suddenly whitewashed as Democrats and people who are for human rights and justice. Mm-hmm. And those people have been empowered ever since. And along with those known war criminals, the United States conducted a war against Taliban in Afghanistan, resulting into many, many, many victims for the last 19 years. Mm-hmm. And on the other side, the Taliban as a rebel, as an opposition force, as an insurgent group, however you want to call it, they have committed many, many attacks where many civilians were killed. Yeah. And this is a reality in Afghanistan. There is no party in this war that is not that is innocent. All of them bear responsibility for the suffering of the people of Afghanistan. And if there is no justice, if there is no prosecution, or at least some sort of reconciliation, I don't think that Afghanistan will become a stable and peaceful country in a short period. So that's why ICC is very important. If it's not ICC, the international community need to confront the United States and the powerful figures in Afghanistan for what they have done in Afghanistan. This is necessary.
It's definitely necessary. And thank you so much again for being here. Or as we wrap up the hour, and this was such a necessary discussion as well. And I hope we can continue this. You know, we, as long as we keep on talking about this, then people will realize that there are people keeping a close eye on this, and it's not just being something that's happening super far away and is not still affecting our communities. So thank you so much, Brother Pekar, for being here. And to all of you, thank you for being here. And we're having our Free Kashmir digital rally tomorrow at 10 Eastern, 2 GMT, with 8 or 9 powerful Kashmiri speakers. Please join us tomorrow on Muslim Network TV. Thank you so much. Assalamu alaikum.